him. I always observe, just as I observed this morning, that most of the pulpit here are not so good for you because you struggle read the text straight and make sure that you can use it. And yet the irony is there that when I come here, and even when I pull it, there is still another disadvantage. I can't be able to see him from my I want this to ask a question, and it will be a form of request. I'm wondering in the world of technology today, whether we cannot have a speaker-friendly pulpit or yes, just press the button and down. So when Dr. Park and Dr. Goptil come, perhaps if it's not anywhere, why don't they take it? Let I have. Yes, it is always my struggle, and if you come home, you'll find most of the pulpits are this size or shorter, and it won't be comfortable for you. I think that would be a good thing. Now, we are talking about a devotional which has been allocated about 8 to 10 minutes. I'm thinking about preaching the word. Preach the word. And the words of Paul are pertinent here. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, Paul writes that, I'm quoting NIV, in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge. Preach the word. And then he adds on, correct, rebuke, and encourage. With great patience and careful instruction. Some of the phrases here, the words here are a bit of soul striking. When he says, in the presence of God and Christ, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, you see the language he's using. He's lifting you and me in the presence of God, and the presence of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the angels. And when they are there seated looking at you and me, then Paul charges you and me. So that God and the angels and the heavenly beings become witnesses to the charge that Paul is making. What a solemn charge. And what is he charging Timothy to do? He's charging him to preach the word. In a generation described as postmodern, Brother Koto presented that topic yesterday, where no absolutes, where no rules, binding rules, no binding text, the Bible is questioned, everything is questioned, and everything is explained in terms of whether it works for the one who is reading or taking the rule or whatever. When in such a situation, we find ourselves, the church is finding itself, preachers are finding themselves in a situation where they have to redo and redefine and re-explain. The phenomenon we saw yesterday where subject told us he, one young lady says, but the Bible says, in other words, then don't tell me of the absolutes when there are the opens. In a situation like this one, we seem to neglect this charge that is given to us in the presence of God, the owner of the scripture and the owner of the will that he has given us to proclaim to the world. So in the presence of Jesus Christ and in the presence of God, God on his throne, Paul is saying, I am giving you a charge, preach the word and nothing else. Use the word to correct and to rebuke and to encourage. Now, there are some words that he uses here. When, especially the word giving a charge, diamanturn romai in Greek, it may be a solemn affirmation, a solemn charge, a testimony, which brings about Paul, the intensity of Paul's work and the situation and the issue that he's trying to put across. And especially when it comes to Jesus Christ and all the divinity being the witnesses of what Paul is saying, it becomes even tense. But now we are caught between the two forces. The force of God's will, which is saying, do this. And the force of compromise, which is saying, by the way, what you are telling me, can it work for me? And I think as the Christians and as preachers and as church leaders, we better be careful as we are dealing with situations. I'll tell you of a story. I don't know when it happened, but it is told. In the colonial time in Africa, one of the things, institutions that the colonialists established were prisons. And they built prisons depending on the population at that time. But like the population of Uganda, by the time of independence, we were about 14, 15 million. But now we are about 36 million. But some of these structures, the prisons, still remain the same size. And so when the prison authorities thought about this, we have too many people entering and too many coming out. Why do we still keep this small gate, this small door of the prison? Why don't we widen it? It was an old building. And so they called the mansion to work on it, and then brought the hammers and the mallets to break the wall and so that they can fix a bigger door to the entrance of the prison house. And you know, as they were hitting, they used still the prisoners as the labor. So they employed, they told them to begin hitting the wall. So as they were hitting at the wall here, behind there, the building was giving in. It was breaking because of the vibrations here. So they are hitting here, the blocks are falling at the other end. Hitting here, the blocks are falling. By the time they finished opening and removing the old door frame, there was a big, big opening behind there, and all the prisoners were going one by one. This is a phenomenon which we normally describe as the back door. And I want to submit that oftentimes, as we try to soften the values, the principles of the church, we are creating for the phenomenon of the back door to be opened. This is very true, as I think many of you who have been in the church for a longer time than myself will realize that it is true. The apostasies were not as many as they are today. It's because we are bringing in indiscriminately, and people who are not properly grounded in the church are going out without any feeling that they are doing the right thing. And therefore, I want to go to what Paul is saying. In the presence of the Lord, he is charging us to preach the word. And I want to say that we should go to the word and preach the word. Ground the people in the principles of our faith and the principles of the Bible. We may bring in fewer, as Pastor Ekoto said, he will be in charge of. We may bring in that process, as we are deeply grounding these people, we may not bring in so many people as we do today. But you can be sure that many of those people we bring in will be able to stay, than bringing in people endlessly and they go out in big numbers. May the Lord help us as we continue to think about the issues of faith and crisis in Africa, that we may be able to go to the Bible and do things according to the Word of God, because that is the only way people can stay in the church.